in the temporal space of music. First of all, silence is perfectly symmetrical. So we can listen to one bit of silence, it's the same as the next. A sustained sound is symmetrical, although one of my colleagues in Australia pointed out that if you give a singer one note to sing, they will not sing it the same for the whole time. And we have this inbuilt desire to break the symmetry. And in fact, if I had a student who was playing one single note the same from beginning to end, what I would say is bring it to life. It's dead. Going back to Stravinsky, if it's perfectly symmetrical, it's perfectly dead. But anyway, let's pretend that if we were playing on an organ, the sound is perfectly the same. It's symmetrical. And tremolo, which is a technique in which if I, on the violin, play as fast as I can with the bow backwards and forwards, we get... If all of you did the same thing, it would be exactly the same as the idea of the applause. So we'd get this homogeneous sound that, again, has these tiny perturbations in it, but in fact, it really has the same symmetry as a gas. So here's a perfectly symmetrical bit of rhythmic space. We can add a beat that reduces the symmetry, just as when we started to applaud. We can add meter. By meter, I mean 2/4, two beats in a bar. So some beats are more important than others. We reduce the symmetry again. We can put this into slightly bigger groups. Slightly bigger groups again, and on, and then we can summarise by saying that on the highly symmetrical side we have silence, sustained sound, and tremolo. I should say prolonged silence, because a short silence can sometimes be important information, but a prolonged silence. Beat, meter, hypermeter, and deeper periodic structures, less symmetrical, but still symmetrical. So we reduce symmetry as we go from one side to the other. Here's an example from Beethoven's Seventh Symphony, and I think we can hear that high symmetry is associated with the absence of hierarchy and differentiation in this first woodwind chord. And this symmetrical structure has a low information content. In fact, it really has no information content as far as where is the beat. And I'm sure you know this. I'll just turn it up a little. So no rhythmic information. What's wonderful about this is that we don't just get a beat and nothing else. We go immediately from nothing to beat plus meter plus phrase in binary expansion. And it's, I think, I'm not a crystallographer, but it seems to me very similar to a crystal, where as you crystallize, you don't just get one axis or one little bit of symmetry, you get the whole thing growing at once. So typically in music, and in popular music, this is almost the norm. Well, I'd say it is the norm. Very uncommon to break from this norm of this binary expansion. So we've seen that it's associated with introduction of information, but it's also associated with stability. And if we imagine trying to dance or march to that, that would be easy. If we try to dance or march to this from Stravinsky, not so easy. One of the reasons that The Rite of Spring was so hated in its first performance, it's one thing to be hated by the audience, but if it's also hated by the performers and the dancers, the composer is on a hiding to nothing. And remember the self-organizing periodic neural networks. So this is what makes us want this organization. Now, there's a problem here when we get to pitch, because we've said that symmetry should be associated with stability, but here is a particularly stable structure in Western music, and it sounds like this. But we can see on the clock face that it's actually asymmetrical. So how can we explain that? Now, just a reminder that here we go from asymmetry and stability, increasing symmetry and becoming increasingly unstable. Once again, I'm not making a value judgment, but talking about symmetry and stability. The answer, I'm sure, is in the harmonic series. And the harmonic series is the notion that if we play a note, for example, the low A at the bottom of the bass clef on the score up there, in the air, we also get the harmonic series, the overtones of that A. And these are organized according to integer multiples of the fundamental frequency. Now, we can see them up the top there, and they sound like this. There's lots of ways you can produce these. For example, if you have a brass instrument, if you keep blowing increasingly harder, applying more pressure, you go up the harmonic series, which is the principle behind playing a brass instrument. On a string instrument, if you keep dividing the string into equal portions, you get the same series. It's absolutely ingrained in nature. And this particular part of the series is particularly important, and here we have at the base the interval of a perfect fifth, and above that the interval of a perfect fourth. So ingrained that there's a lot of research to say that, in fact, even within the first year of life, children seem to respond to these intervals in a different way than they respond to other intervals. So ingrained that every time you get an SMS, you hear these three notes. Next, we can add the third of the chord, the C sharp there, so ingrained. Whenever you turn on your Mac, you hear this chord. And I've been interested, as I've gone around Europe, every train station that I've been in has a little ding-dong when they're about to make an announcement based on these five notes of the harmonic series, except for the one in Kecskemét in Hungary, the home of Zoltán Kodály, which actually plays a little fragment from Zoltán Kodály himself, which breaks this symmetry. So in solfège, we can see these represented here, and these always sound stable. We can use them at the beginning of the piece. And you can feel the stability there. Or we can use them at the end of the piece, and they sound stable as long as do, as long as the tonic is at the bottom. Takes rather longer than some to convince you of the stability. So my approach in our cymbals, it doesn't make sense to use the asymmetrical clock face depiction of this major triad. So in my descriptions, I will use this. It looks like an E, it's not an E, it's just to show that there's this integer relationship, this harmonic series relationship. So whenever you see that E, we've got the tonic triad. And just to show you, there's the tonic triad, stable. There's the diminished seventh chord, augmented triad, both symmetrical. Debussy's favorite, the whole tone scale. All various degrees of disorder. So now we come to one of these symmetrical chords, the diminished seventh, and this is the Count Dracula chord. And as you hear this chord, there is no way in the world that we could possibly orient ourselves to which note is home. It's not because we're not good enough musicians. Beethoven couldn't do it. This chord is disorients us because of its symmetry. But the dominant seventh has a particular way of resolving so that we do get orientation. And what happens in a diminished seventh typically is that one of its notes falls by one half step to produce an asymmetrical chord, which we call a dominant seventh. And this chord doesn't make us feel at home, but it shows us absolutely where we must go. Now, I'll play this a couple of times, and the first time I'm not going to play the last chord, but I want you to imagine in your head where you think we might be heading. Ah, I heard someone singing it. Let's see if you were right. Of course, as my six-year-old student said, yes, I was right, you were all right. So, but I think you can hear that it has this absolute sense of direction that the diminished seventh doesn't have. But because the diminished seventh is a symmetrical, it's a symmetrical chord, it mightn't surprise you to know that actually it can take us in four completely different directions. So as we go through, we'll hear the same set of notes first each time, but it will take us in a different direction each time. So first of all, to G major. Disorientation, orientation, resolution. Now in E major. Disorientation, which fiddle with another note, orientation, resolution. Disorientation, orientation. That slide sometimes takes a little while to catch up with itself. But I think you can hear, and if we look at this little clock face here, the grey square indicates the diminished seventh that we started with. The black square indicates the keys that we've gone to. And not surprisingly, it has the same symmetry as the diminished seventh itself. So we can add to our list one more thing, and that is that symmetry is associated with in music with multivalence. Now, we might actually skip over to this one just to save time. This is an example from Franz Liszt, and we can see here, just by looking at it, that Franz Liszt immerses us in a sea of symmetry and a sea of disorder. And it sounds like this. Eventually, we can't take it anymore. Orientation and arrival, and on he goes. So from a thermodynamic point of view, it's as if Liszt is opening the picture on a system already at a critical point. And it's these self-organizing networks that make us want a resolution. Shall we just listen to it once more so we can hear that? Disorientation. Perfect translational symmetry of the first phrase, so we get no new information. Information breaks here, orients us. In fact, Liszt breaks the rules of how we should resolve that dominant seventh and takes us home via the back door. But that leads us nicely to this slide. At the top we can see a traditional resolution of diminished seventh chord, orientation, disorientation, which would lead to arrival, and it's this process. But at the bottom we see another way of resolving or breaking the symmetry of a diminished seventh, and that is that if we take a note, in this case the D, and we raise it a semitone to a D sharp, just as we do here, we get the chord on the end, which is this chord, which is famously called the Tristan chord. Now, Tristan is, Wagner didn't call this an opera, he called it a music drama. And part of the reason for that is that the music itself should inform us as much about the story as the text or the drama. So it's very relevant for us to think about these things of thermodynamics, of rhetoric, in relation to the harmony, because Wagner expected us to. It was written in the late 1850s. Two important influences. One was his love affair with Wesendonck, who was the wife of one of his major benefactors. It was written in response to the philosophy of Arthur Schopenhauer, and it was described as an unperformable opera. In Vienna, after 80 rehearsals, they decided it was unperformable, and it wasn't performed until, I think, 6 or 8 years later. This chord has baffled musicologists ever since, and here's one of, you can find these sort of quotes everywhere. The Tristan chord has almost seemed to serve as a touchstone against which any theory of harmony must prove itself. And I was fascinated to discover last week that at the CERN laboratory there's a place called Isolde, and I thought that maybe after you've found the Higgs boson you can try and help us out and resolve the Tristan chord. I suspect you'll have more luck with the Higgs boson. So here it is. We'll listen just to the beginning of it again to remind you. disorientation, orientation, but no arrival. Takes the music up a little, does it again. And in between each phrase, long silences. Now, we'll keep going because we'll hear it again, but let's start to look at the symmetry. So if we're going to break symmetry, we must have symmetries to start with. So the first symmetry is the chromatic scale, and this has the symmetry of the whole entire clock face. There's a couple of little bits of repetition in the middle, but if we ignore those, the oboe, starting in the G sharp in the second whole bar, begins an ascent that goes all the way to a G sharp an octave higher. So there's no note in this clock face that's missed out. And amazingly, once he's traversed that entire scale, he then breaks the symmetry and reaches up for a B and then falls to an A. So where are those? There's the first set, there's the second set, the third set, which is repeated. Then he takes just these two little notes and repeats them there and there. Takes those two little notes again and builds on them. And there we have that structure. So he adds to this a very interesting symmetry, which is very unusual in Germanic music, and that is this rhythmic pattern of long, short, short, long. This is very common, for example, in Hungarian music, but very unusual because of the differences in the language in Germanic and English music. And so he repeats it. And he adds one note, but still we have long, short, 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 long. Did I do one too many shorts in there? Perhaps I did. He repeats that. Then here he just takes the last part, but preserves the rhythm, short, long. And here he does something really quite beautiful. Now he's inverted the whole of the opening for his climactic moment. So instead of being bookended by longs, we're now bookended by shorts with longer notes in the middle. The next symmetry is to be found between the oboe and the cello. So the cellos go up, then come down. Now, they don't happen at exactly the same time, as you can see, but if we just pretend for a minute that they do, we find that the oboe goes up, cello goes down by exactly the same set. Oboe goes up, cello goes down. Oboe goes up, cello goes down until that note, and here he breaks the symmetry of that process. Now, there's another symmetry that we can start to see, which is that the second phrase looks a lot like the first phrase, and the third phrase looks a lot like the second phrase, but not quite. Philip Bass in 1996 made this construction, which is what Tristan Prelude would look like if everything was perfectly translated. He goes through this set of phrases. The first phrase starts on a G sharp, the last phrase starts on an F, and if we were to go one more step, he would start the next phrase on the G sharp one octave higher, and Tristan would go forever. It goes for 6 hours as it is. I don't think we want it to be any longer. But the interesting thing, and I completely agree with Bass's, you've got to make some decisions if you're going to do this sort of thing. I completely agree with his interpretation of it. And the interesting thing is that it turns out that the wrong note, if we want to call it the wrong note, is actually the first note of the whole piece. So in Bass's rewriting, it begins with a G sharp. In Wagner, it begins with an A. So it begins with a fluctuation, in a sense. And if we look at these, if we look at the first two notes of the cello part each time, we can start to see why these fluctuations are important. Because the first two notes of the cello consist of this set of notes, A, B, D, F, and G sharp. And there's only one possible structure that can fit in traditional harmony, and that's this scale, the A harmonic minor scale, unless we were to go into unusual modes, which certainly was not part of Wagner's harmonic language. So it's as if we've got two competing systems. We've got the chromatic world on one side and this A minor world on another side. And it's perhaps a little bit like a ping pong ball. If you imagine a ping pong ball compressed from all around, as the pressure increases, it's going to buckle. And it's almost as if this chromatic scale compressed from all around buckles. We don't know which way it's going to buckle. And in fact, it buckles into the A minor form. And chromatic symmetry buckles into diatonic asymmetry. So here are the little perturbations that allow this to happen. First of all, there's the minor sixth in the opening cello leap. It becomes a major sixth, so one half step wider. That's preserved in the next phrase. But then in the third phrase, there's an extra note. And these are the tiny little fluctuations. Without these perturbations or fluctuations, he couldn't do what he couldn't get to where he needs to at the end. Now, we go on to a harmonic analysis, and by analysing each vertical structure in the music with these clock face diagrams, we find these interesting things. First of all, that the Tristan chord, we've already seen this, has this this shape. What it finishes with is our old friend, the dominant seventh, which is the chord of orientation, but not of arrival, and these have their own symmetry. Now, this is not new, this has been known before, but we can see here this beautiful symmetry between them. And so the Tristan chord and the dominant seventh are inversions of each other, but have a completely different character. So inversion in pitch gives us a different character. In the middle of these two chords, we get two other distinct harmonic sonorities. And one looks like this, one looks like that. Again, they're both symmetrical structures, and if we put it all together, the first phrase looks like that. The second phrase is the same. The third phrase is the same, but adds an equilateral triangle in the middle. And so each of these structures has its own symmetry. And the last phrase, which is where we're coming into the arrival point, things go crazy until finally we get to this magical moment of arrival. This is married to this unusual rhythm, and so the harmonic symmetry relates beautifully to the rhythmic symmetry. Where is the arrival? We've seen disorientation, orientation, but no arrival, and it comes right at the end of that bar that we heard at the end of the, when we heard it at the beginning, and we can see that it's an arrival of sorts. But he adds one extra note, which muddies the waters. It resolves, as it should, but it's that one extra note that also allows him to keep this process going for the next 6 hours. It's a story about impossible love, and he uses these harmonies to show that. So when we put all of this together, this is the picture that we get. Now, if we look at the rhythmic analysis of this music, we see a similar thing. It's easy to show that to establish a periodic pattern, we need three isochronous events. If I give you one clap, you've got no way of predicting when the next one will be. If I give you two claps, you can predict when the next one will be, but you're not sure. It's only when I give you three that you could keep it going. So here we're looking for groups of three, and wherever you see a double red square, these are new musical events. So we're looking for a group of three, and in the first phrase we get one right at the end, and then he stops. So he sets us up with the rhythm and then stops. Then we get silence, highly symmetrical. The second phrase, the same thing, three and then stops. The third phrase, four and then stops. Fourth phrase, four, and then stops. The fifth and sixth little segments, nothing. And then finally, the cellos and basses and the bottom part of the orchestra come in, and now here is periodicity. Our harmonic arrival point is just here, and we can see that it's the one, two, third event in our series of isochronous events. So just at the moment that the harmony resolves is also the moment that we can be certain of our rhythmic periodicity. So Professor Cagliotti's description here of symmetry breaking, let's see how this fits into this music. And we start with this phrase that interrupts the symmetry of silence, then more silence. Many people would call this, even today, incoherent noise and disorder, but Wagner intended it to be incoherent. He intended us to think, what on earth is going on there? We start to get some fluctuations, which are important in this process, because those fluctuations direct us towards A minor more than any other key. Then we get an extra note, which is a stimulus for change, control, etc., and listen to it and we'll see. So with the addition of those notes, the symmetric process of rising phrases stops and how he repeats a phrase. So control is beginning to come into the structure. More control is taken by just taking a small element of those. Now the orchestra cooperates. And here is our moment. And from there on, throughout the rest of the prelude, we can pretty much tell what key we're in, apart from a couple of other important moments. So, in summary, Stravinsky said to be perfectly symmetrical is to be perfectly dead, and I would add that to live is to break symmetry. And where is this leading us? Further, the current work is analysis of this process in a wide range of works and styles, looking at symmetry and symmetry breaking as a model for the evolution of form and style in Western music, the idea of symmetry and symmetry breaking in rhetoric, and this can be closely allied to information theory, and finally, symmetry and symmetry breaking in music education. But for the future, I'm very interested in the idea that tonal music we can look at as a dissipative system, following Ilya Prigogine's model, and I need much help from many of you to understand those processes better, and musical entropy. Talking about musical energy is very difficult. We all sort of feel that we know where it is, but nobody's ever brave enough to write it down in any authoritative way, and perhaps this could help a way forward with understanding musical energy. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much,
David. This was real. Applause. Have we got 2 minutes to hear where it does resolve?
Yes. That's what in the 2 minutes.
So the purpose of Wagner's opera is to show really impossible love. And in fact, if you know the story, everybody acts in a good way. There is no evil villain. This is not Rigoletto. But it's the circumstances and a love potion which makes people act in a way that they shouldn't. But everybody's trying to do the right thing. So this is impossible, ambiguous love. And it's not until the very end, and this is called by Wagner the Liebestod, the death of love, the very end, Tristan is already dead. Isolde is about to die. And I should say I saw a dress rehearsal of this in Munich once with this enormous glass panel which turned in beautiful light during these last chords, and Tristan, who was lying dead, suddenly realized that he was going to be crushed by this glass window. So this dead, enormous body on the floor moved about a foot to avoid being hit by the glass. Right at the end, we'll hear the final resolution of this phrase. there we have it.
Thank you very much. I would vote 2 more minutes to you if you have such illustrations. Really, both the graphical and the musical illustrations of symmetry in music was very impressive, at least for me. I'm not a specialist in music, so I would like to add something to the structure and the interpretation of symmetry and symmetry baking and its connection with order, disorder. So, generally, when musicians speak or write about the classification of symmetries in music, they refer to the crystallographers. So in the crystallography, the symmetry is associated with the order, or order is associated with the symmetry. But it is not the case with physicists. Physicists, at least in thermodynamics, interpret just in the opposite. So their symmetry is associated with the disorder, and order is associated with the asymmetry. Once I showed that they use these terms in different meanings. Only I wanted to draw your attention that it is some like a controversial in the interpretation of different disciplines. So, who has any questions and or comments?
You mentioned at the beginning you mentioned symmetry reduction and symmetry breaking in music. Is there a difference, and if yes, what is the difference in these two words which you have used?
Yes, well, I think for me it was a great concern when I discovered, as I showed you, that the tonic chord is asymmetric. And so that seemed to me that we were actually breaking symmetry rather than reducing symmetry. Then I was in correspondence with Professor Cagliotti, who really suggested that we should be referring to symmetry reduction, that we are always left with some symmetry. And that really challenged me to find what is the symmetry in the tonic chord. And the harmonic series for me was the answer, because the structures related to the harmonic series are the only asymmetric and stable structures in music. There are many other asymmetric structures in music, but they're all unstable. So I think it's a valid argument to say that, in fact, that's the... So I think I would probably, in that respect now, be happy to say symmetry reduction rather than symmetry breaking.
You know, one major aspect of symmetry and symmetry breaking is the tempo. You know, without the tempo, we cannot perceive anything. But the breaking there is what we call music interpretation. Mm-hmm. You know, everyone can break it the way you want. Mm-hmm. And the fact of the matter is that you can play Tristan to a computer, people will simply dream and, you know, fall apart.
Fall asleep.
And that. But once you hear it on stage, like what we heard here, the Lipstock, which was a very beautiful way she played it, it was full of symmetry breaking in the tempo.
Yes.
And this is how she relates to our emotion.
Yes. So what you're saying is that musicians actually rarely perform, classical musicians, we don't often perform music with the beat exactly the same from one beat to the next. And so this brings the music to life. And we would say to a musician who's playing every beat exactly the same, it sounds dead. Give it life, please. If there's too much of that sort of symmetry breaking, it becomes impossible and ghastly, and then you have Liberace. Yes.
I was wondering about the relationship between patterns in mathematics and patterns in music. Like you were saying, after a finite number, you can see the pattern of notes. So, for example, C, D, E, and then the next set of intervals, which are major seconds apart. But in mathematics, if you start with 1, 2, 3, and then you say, okay, what's the next, what's the pattern? It could be 3, 2, 1, or it could be 4, 5, 6 after 1, 2, 3. And then there are an infinite number of ways, it would seem, that you can see a pattern in mathematics, whereas in music, one makes a decision after just a small number.
Yes and no. I think there comes a critical number when there are the more information we have, the less the possibilities are. And so, for example, in the Adagietta from the Fifth Symphony of Mahler that many of you perhaps know, begins with two notes, a C and an A, which doesn't have enough information to tell us, is this A minor or F major? And he sustains this for quite some time before he resolves it into beautiful F major. But it could go the other way. And in fact, there's a wonderful piece of film music of John Williams where he uses exactly the same two notes to reference Mahler and actually takes us the other way to A minor. So when we hear just a couple of notes, we can be easily confused, and that's part of the ambiguity of it. But in this case, where I said the A, the B, the D, the F, and the G sharp, there's only one scale possible that would have that set of notes in Western harmony, and that would be the A harmonic minor. If we took the G sharp away, then there would be quite a number of possible scales. But the G sharp is the information that we need to absolutely orient us there.
So this is in the context that you've done sort of, you know, once we've got major and minor scales, and then the C, G, the major chord is breaking the symmetry yet stable. Even just within the context of Western music going earlier, what happens if you look at Renaissance music and modal things? Do you find similar structures which appear as stable, although they're not as symmetric?
Well, I think this is a very interesting, because I think we can actually see the evolution of musical history. It's sometimes symmetry breaking, sometimes symmetry increasing, but we can look at it in those terms. And I think from in the Renaissance, they would use different modes, and there were five perhaps particularly commonly used, and the modes were sort of equally available to composers. One of the interesting things was that narrowed down to two in the Baroque period, and to me that's an example of symmetry breaking. But at the same time, the rhythm in the Renaissance beat was always there, was called the tactus, but meter wasn't necessarily the same through all the voices. So if you were the tenor, you might be singing with four beats in a bar. Partway through, if I was the bass, I might suddenly sing with three beats in a bar, two beats in a bar, and come back to join you. So we wouldn't all, the meter was related to the word stress in each part rather than everybody doing the same thing. So we could say that, relatively speaking, every beat of the music was invariant. One of the things the Baroque period did was to crystallize that into meter, so that everybody in the orchestra, in the choir, is doing the same thing. So I think we can definitely see examples of symmetry breaking, symmetry reduction, as we come from Renaissance into the Baroque. And the interesting thing is that the Renaissance composers with that used more symmetrical structures, inversions, for example, canons. That seemed to go together, the idea of this symmetrical sense of time and symmetrical use of melodic material.
Was there anything in particular in Dorian and Aeolian modes that stood out symmetrically, that they were the ones that the Baroque picked? I mean, within the analysis, are they distinctive?
The major scale is distinctive for a number of reasons, and one of them is that the what we call the tetrachord, which is the bottom four notes, is actually the same as the upper tetrachord. So C D E F is the same as G A B C in its intervals. Why that was chosen? Because there are some other ones that the Phrygian mode also works the same. Why that was chosen over others is very hard to say.
The last question.
Just a very naive one. We talk about left brain, right brain. To what extent do these great composers, were they conscious of these elements?
Really not until the 20th century. And in the 20th century, as time went on, people became specifically aware of symmetry. Schoenberg and his followers developed techniques which use symmetry, although they didn't really, they weren't really thinking, they didn't go to a symmetry school and come back and say this is the answer. They developed techniques that in retrospect we can see were symmetrical. But then later in the 40s, 50s, people really specifically started to use symmetry. And perhaps the greatest of all is Andrzej Panufnik, the Polish composer, who really made his life's work trying to make symmetrical music that worked. Some of it did work, some of it, I think most people would agree, didn't work. So it's really a late 20th century phenomenon that that has employed consciously symmetry. But symmetry breaking, almost nobody has consciously used. There's one person I know that perhaps has. So that's a new approach.
Okay. Since the name of Giuseppe Pagliotti was mentioned several times during your presentation, so the last word is now given to Giuseppe.
Thank you for what you have said. This was very interesting. I think I noticed that at the beginning of the Tristano Prelude, you have a continuous, continuous sound and symmetric, and you have the same. Perhaps the same structure. I mean, at the end, you have this, like in the Goldberger, you start with aria, and you even don't recognize at the end that you end up with the same aria.
Yes.
But so this is a rhetoric proposal, but. I think that at the end, this long note is loaded, although they are very similar, at the end there is a much more rich musical content. And this comes now to the point of the last point you made on the energy in the music. I think you should find it in the ambiguous region between where you pass from a symmetric fragment of the score to another kind of symmetry, and you are still in the old symmetry structure, and then you enter into the new one. Perhaps this is the point where energy ambiguity go together.
Yeah.
Do you agree on that?
I would be very grateful, because this is something that I'm not an expert in, and so I would happily agree, and I have, as I say, instinctive feelings about where energy is going, but if there were people who are physicists and mathematicians that would like to help me in this area, I would be extremely grateful, because I think that's a very important area. Yeah, so thank you very much.
Thank you very much.